Gurukul lecture series, and we are running a series of lectures called Romantic Trend in English Writing. As you all know, that there was a period in the latter half of the 18th century and the first half of the 19th century, and these 40-50 years, they were given to a very specific literary trend which was called Romanticism. Under this trend, many important authors came up, and they gave expression to a different kind of perspective, different kind of views. In that series today, we have a lecture by Dr. Richa Bajaj, who teaches English literature in Delhi University's Hindu College. She is a scholar of not merely English literature, but also of writing in India. And she has been straddling the two worlds in a very competent manner, giving interpretation that is required today. And she also has studied literary theory deeply. So we have with us Dr. Richa Bajaj as a resource person, and she'll be giving a lecture on Mary Shelley, Frankenstein. Now, all of us have been aware in the last 10-15 years about this text, Frankenstein, in so many ways, and we interpret, we understand different things from it. We understand the nature of evil, the nature of goodness, by contrast, all these things, and it is supposed to be one of the representative romantic texts. So we have Dr. Richa Bajaj, and I request her to kindly give a lecture. Welcome, Dr. Richa Bajaj, and please start your lecture.
Thank you, Dr. Anand Prakash. Today I thought we'll speak about Mary Shelley and a female voice in Romanticism, and dealing with fiction writing. Romantics were really fond of the lyric, and wrote poetry. But here is a woman who's of course, because of her background and the parents, the literary celebrities as her parents that she has, she is able to dabble in fiction and is able to bring together both the poetic and the dramatic in her fictional work. And that is, and there is so much passion in what she writes that you seldom find a writing like that in the period. Of course, Mary Shelley was also influenced, like most of these romantic writers were, was influenced by the Gothic trend. And this novel was actually written as a kind of a as a kind of a practice, as a kind of a fun practice, where all of them, she with her friends, decided to write a tale of horror, and this is how she went on writing about it. But you know, the point is that the romantics were equally critical of the Gothic trend, even as they were impressed by it, and they used it to some extent, whether it was Blake or Coleridge. They tried to dabble with the Gothic form. They were also critical. Very soon they came out of it, and came to talk about the world. Wordsworth from the beginning thought that this was so to speak a pernicious form, or belonged to the low cultures, and was a part of what today we call the pulp culture or the low cultures. If we take the cultural materialist approach, then that becomes now the new space through which we intervene in society and we analyze society. But in that period, the Gothic literature or the Gothic writings, the Gothic fiction particularly, was seen as a kind of a refuge from this kind of daunting life that industrialization had produced, and it became a kind of an escape. It brought thrill, horror to it, but this became a way of escaping the mundane and the mechanical that was overpowering for the 19th century readers. So you see, Gothic literature at that time really surfaced as the commercial kind of literature. Now, when Mary Shelley deals with this particular genre, then she doesn't limit it to its entertaining spectacle value or the thrill value. She is able to add, consciously or not, she is able to add many layers to this particular novel of hers, which is more like a drama and less like the novel. She is able to make it a kind of a finished, established canonical piece that we know it to be today. Also, because she adds constantly in this work of hers, she draws inspiration from these writers such as Milton, or she freely quotes writers from her contemporary writers such as Coleridge. So she'd use a poem of from the Ancient Mariner, and one of her characters would quote it, or the epigraph of her novel has been taken from Paradise Lost. So in a way, she's been able to make inroads into the canonical established literature by using this kind of a mode, by using the Gothic and then adapting it to a more literary or a more conventional kind of writing. That is one aspect of it. The other is that she is also able to add a lot of debate, the ongoing political debate of the time, which was around the French Revolution, its relevance, what was it like, how the writers responded to it. So Mary Shelley actually uses this novel as a way of also exploring the happenings of the French Revolution. And I'll speak to you when we come to the textual bits, where she actually at one point commenting on the French Revolution, she calls the masses the giant that has now woken up. So, in that sense, she's able to also bring in a kind of a political allegory in her work. Having said this, it's not to read the entire novel as a kind of a political allegory, but that these flashes can't be missed. And when we look today at Frankenstein, then it's not looked at just kind of a gothic horror tale. Critics have read so much into it, and the idea of the political allegory has come from the 20th century critics, who actually believe that that she wrote it with French Revolution in mind. So of course this is a post study that we are doing today, and from the benefit of hindsight that we have today, we try to fit in things. But of course she wasn't writing, so to speak, a political allegory. So that needs to be kept in mind. The other thing is that it works also as a kind of a religious allegory, because she is using Milton's Paradise Lost, and constantly there are references to the fall or Adam. I'll probably be able to point that out from the text when Frankenstein, who creates this monster, has to answer the question of the monster, who says that I was supposed to be your Adam, but now I'm fallen. So you see the idea of the fall and that the creation, and he says you are my creator, you have a responsibility towards me, you can't just leave me in a fallen world, or leave me to deal with the situation. So again, the Miltonic tradition of epic writing continues through her works. Of course it's not an epic, but she's using the ideas. At one level, it's also a very intellectual kind of novel, because she's exploring ideas. She's exploring the nature of fall, the nature of creation, the sense of responsibility that a creator must have vis-a-vis one's creation, if at all, and the spirit of scientific inquiry that was increasingly becoming important in the 19th century. How was one to deal with these things? And so what happened as a result of, how she was trying to deal with the ideas of her age, the result was that this novel ceases to fit in any one paradigm, and which is why it has left critics berserk. They have not been able to analyze it. Some of them have found the novel to be weak for the reason that it is unable to provide a kind of direction to the reader. The reader doesn't know where to sympathize with whom, and it always the writer goes with one kind of consciousness of a character and then shifts her focus and then starts believing in the consciousness of the other. So in that sense, because of her shifting narratives, because of the contradictions that emerge from the text, some critics have actually called it a kind of a weak text. On the other hand, there are critics who have believed this to be an advantage of the text, that it talks about the contradictions that 19th century life was fraught with, and that the 19th century reader had to deal with, and that basic question then came out as to how do you negotiate this relationship, or how do you project this kind of clash between scientific inquiry and the spirit of scientific inquiry on the one hand, and the political moral ethos that the society has been preserving and has been upholding for itself. Do they come in a state of, do they clash with one another? And if they do, then what is the resolution? Which side should the society go? Should it go in the direction of science and leave faith and morality aside? Or should it uphold the questions of morality, faith, and questions of human life? Should it preserve those human values and restrict science? So you see that this kind of a clash comes into being, and it's very starkly presented in the novel. This is how I'd like to open my discussion on Mary Shelley.
Actually, you are touching upon a very important aspect of literary writing, and that aspect is that this is supposed to be a romantic thing, and if romantic experience is to be captured, then the novel would be the last mode of writing. The novel is based in realism. In the 18th century, when the novel began as a major mode of expression, then people started thinking of narratives and characters and a kind of situation in which they'll be put, and then there will be a kind of moral at the end. Now that is the structure of the novel. Now this is a romantic experience that is being captured through the novel. So there seems to be a contradiction in terms. A novel cannot by definition be romantic in nature. Would you agree with this?
Yes, I think
And you also refer to Milton. You refer to drama. In poetry you have drama till the end of the 17th century. Drama
even
was
the romantics are writing dramatic pieces.
Dramatic pieces also,
such as.
But Prometheus. Novel would be the last thing. So you are grappling with an idea which requires still more understanding of things, and the modern critics, as you rightly point out, are not the ones to qualified to talk about this book, because they have read novels in a different form. So I think that they are attacking this text not for it's not being a novel, but for it's being romantic.
You see, in the sense that we understand romantic, what is romantic then? When we say that poetry can be romantic and the novel as a form doesn't allow romanticism to flourish, and the form of the novel necessarily brings you down to reality, and you must talk about the real, and you cannot work with the imaginative, you cannot remain in a kind of reverie also for as long as you are writing the novel. The novel requires some kind of, you need to sustain the novel and its plot, and that can't be done in some kind of a flash. Like poetry can be written in that kind of flash, like Kubla Khan, or when Wordsworth recollects, then it's that moment, that spontaneous. How long can you hold that spontaneity in a novel? So obviously that question comes into being, and for this reason you see the romantic, how she fits into the romantic mode, is also because that's a figment of imagination. Now the monster, the science, when science becomes too daunting for the reader of the 19th century, then imagination suddenly has to find its resources, right? And imagination has to deal with the questions of science. So in a way she is trying to explore what science can do, and which is why this novel is also seen as a dystopia. That it doesn't, it creates a kind of, it projects a negative view of the future if science is to be the mainstay of our life. And maybe because of that reason, and how imagination then is required, or feeling and emotion is required as it is to be the center of one's life, and science is to be treated as a part of life and not the governing force. So maybe that's how she fits into the romantic mode, because most of them are trying to project the value of emotion and feeling in relation to the principle of rationality that has now become all important for 19th century.
And another thing is that when you talk in the early 19th century, then at the back of it is the French Revolution.
That's right.
Which was there just 11 years before the new century came in. And that revolution had so much hidden inside it. The rage, the excitement, the enthusiasm of the masses,
right,
who were totally sidelined before in literature. So that has its own role to play. Plus, as you say, science is a kind of a monster for society, and the science itself thinks that society is a monster, because society is very irrational according to the scientific principle. So all these different elements in the early 19th century, they form a kind of challenge to the author. And the author, I think, seems to be, as you rightly say, grappling with this problem.
Yeah, so the good, the what I find very interesting about Mary Shelley is that she doesn't have set answers.
Yes.
She's exploratory in her own way, and which is why she's left the readers confused. I'll probably just point out, you know, with the response that came out from Quarterly Review, that the review that the novel got was that it just confused the reader, the 19th century reader, because they wanted some kind of moral to be present there, or some kind of a value system that needs to be reinforced. And Mary Shelley herself is exploring, and she doesn't have set answers beforehand, and so in her exploration she moves, she veers, she actually gives enough, and that perhaps because I feel Mary Shelley, among others, they are so well read, and they belong to, whether even if they write in very simple language, whether it was Wordsworth or Mary Shelley writing in the simplest of language, even then they are well bred, and they are writing in the tradition of the writers, the 18th century writers, and especially Milton. So in that sense, because they have read Milton, because they have read the classics, and particularly in Mary Shelley, I feel the influence of Milton is great, because the way Milton is able to give space to Satan in Paradise Lost, she is able to give a voice to the monster.
Satan is a romantic hero.
Exactly. So Satan becomes a romantic hero, and here, but then the problem arises whether she's, again, the problem that was created vis-a-vis Milton, that whose side are they? Whether Milton was on the side of the devil, and the romantics, are they on the side of God or devil? Here again that problem comes, because Frankenstein, the creator, is seen in the image of God, who has taken the job of God in that sense to create a being.
Interestingly, Milton had given the vocabulary of democracy to Satan, who was fighting against the king, against the Lord.
Right.
So that vocabulary also suited the new times.
Yeah,
they were grappling with the problems of the common masses who were questioning the reign of a king, a monarch.
Right. So in that sense, again, you see, the monster is created and given a voice and is convincing. Even as he commits heinous crimes in the novel, he murders almost everyone who's dear to Victor Frankenstein. Even then, when he speaks, then you can see logic there. You can see where he's coming from. You know that he's not wrong in saying what he's asking. If he wants a companion, then he's not wrong in to ask for a companion. When he says that in the world full of people who have companions, am I to die alone? Can I not have a companion for myself? But that appears to be a danger to Victor Frankenstein, because he sees it will be an onset of another race. While he can create a male monster, he cannot create a female monster. Again, even from 20th century point of view, feminists have tried to talk about the creation, this kind of fear in Frankenstein to create a female monster, because she is more dangerous than a male monster would be.
How come?
she can further the race. Yeah,
yes,
and
yes.
She's the one who can, there'll be a race of giants and monsters. And of course, they have tried to work on it, how a female monster would be something that the male-dominated society of the time cannot take. And that is another kind of intervention.
Positive kind of interpretation of the
right.
tale.
Yes. So, all those points of come into being as you read Shelley's work. So,
I would also agree with you on the question of exploration, because these are questions, and big questions, and people are confronting them, but they don't have any answers.
Right.
But they have to grapple with the questions, and that's why this author is taking the risk of entering that unknown world.
And this is early, Shelley is really a young girl when she's writing this work in 1818, it gets published. As she matures in 1831, she actually revises her text. And it's almost a very apologetic kind of introduction that she adds, that it was really in some mood of hers that she brought this out, and in a sane time she may not have written this, because she now has become conscious of this particular enterprise that came out, and obviously because of the criticism that came along with it, so she tries to trim and that kind of narrative. But you know, in fact, the 1818 version is a more spontaneous version where she's free in giving rein, you know, free rein to her imagination and to build whatever her mind you know, wants to build. So that kind of spontaneity actually exists in her 1818 work.
Mm-hmm.
So with that, viewers, let's look at, since we are into the discussion, let's just try to see where Mary Shelley comes from, when you know, some biographical details about her life, and then we'll come to the text of Frankenstein as well. So you can just see it also on your screens that Mary Shelley was born in 1797 to Mary Wollstonecraft and William Godwin. Now, these two names should actually resonate, because these are two renowned literary figures of the time. They are political philosophers, both of them. Mary Wollstonecraft actually became earned a lot of criticism more than she earned this kind of fame with her A Vindication of the Rights of Woman that came in 1792. So before Mary Shelley was born, Mary Wollstonecraft had become a famous literary figure who was fighting for the rights of women, and even Godwin, for that matter, was a very famous political philosopher who talked about utilitarianism, who talked about political inquiry. And so these are writers, these are two literateurs who are intellectuals in their own rights. And so Mary Shelley has learned from them in a way, you know, her way. And very early in life, Shelley was aware that she would probably, at that time, of course, Godwin, not Shelley, where she was aware that she'd be writing books. And when she grew up, also, as soon as when you know, it was a tragedy for Mary Shelley, because the year that she was born, in the same you know, in a matter of days, Mary Wollstonecraft died soon after giving birth to Mary. And so that, of course, loss was there, but nonetheless, she was taught by her father Godwin, and she had a house full of books, and she was tutored by her father. And later, when she was only 15 years old, she fell in love with Godwin's disciple, P.B. Shelley. And Shelley at that time was only 20, and they met in 1812. That's the period. Godwin did not like this kind of relationship, because Shelley was already married at the time, and because they did not get the kind of acceptance from Godwin, they decided to elope in 1814, and they left for France, went to traveled around Europe, and then settled in London. They were unmarried in this period. Along with them, Mary's stepsister also joined them along on this trip. And then in 1815, Mary gave birth to a daughter who died soon after. And her second child was born, William, a boy, was born in 1816. She lost William also in 1819. So you see, a sense of tragedy and a sense of loss has always been there in Mary Shelley's life. So when she writes 1818, she talks about the death of the loved ones, when she's talking about Victor Frankenstein you know, losing his younger brother, who also incidentally is named William in the text. You know, there is a sense of pain attached to it, and a very personally felt pain that Mary Shelley was able to transfer to her book in Frankenstein. So she had become very early on very aware of loss in 1815, when she lost her daughter, and then in 1819 as she lost her son. Now Mary Shelley and Mary and P.B. Shelley then get married in 1816, and in December. This is soon after, in fact, in the very same year, Mary's half-sister Fanny, she committed suicide. P.B. Shelley's first wife also committed suicide. So two suicides, one in October, the other in November, and in December they actually get married, of 1816. So you see how she was witness to this kind of madness. She was witness to this kind of suicidal instincts that people around her had. And she was able to portray them, therefore, in very graphic terms in the novel. So it's almost like this kind of passion that you see also in Emily Bronte, you know, that kind of passion is also available in Mary Shelley. The way she's able to, with sweep, she's able to talk about the grief of characters and with the sense of depth involved. This actually comes from her, a lot from her personal experience as well.
I think this gives a good background to the text that you'll be discussing now. I'm sure that these tumultuous happenings in her life, they would be reflected in the kind of tale that she finally wove around.
Right.
So I think that's going to be very productive for discussing this novel further.
Yeah. So and soon after in a you have P.B. Shelley who drowns in 1822. So 1819 she loses her son William, and in 1822 she has a miscarriage, in fact, in 1822, and followed by the drowning of P.B. Shelley. So it's like the early years of her life were years of tragedy and loss, and it is after, and then she spent till 1851 when she dies. Till that time she spent time writing her own works and publishing also Shelley's works. She worked on Shelley's literature a lot and was made available because of her efforts largely. That happened. She wrote 6 novels, as you can see on your screen, and these out of the 6, Frankenstein is the first, and it's considered her best because others, there is a kind of maturity and there's a kind of loneliness that comes in other works as well.
I'm sure you'll be able to now tell us about this
thing
further.
Right. So, Frankenstein, let's look at Frankenstein as the subtitle of Frankenstein. Now, it's called the modern Prometheus. Yes. Now, Prometheus, of course, when you talk about the myth of Prometheus, then you're talking about the seeker who had.
I think you can take up the question of the biographical details in Prometheus together after this point is finally made. What do you say?
Let's talk about the subtitle of the novel. It's titled Modern Prometheus. Now, the myth of the Prometheus is actually interesting because Prometheus was the seeker of forbidden knowledge. For being a seeker, he received punishment for his search of this knowledge, and he was tortured eternally by an angry Zeus. Now, Prometheus was then seen as, has been seen alternately as a rebel and a hero. Hero as a seeker, creator, etc. And Frankenstein, to see Frankenstein as a modern Prometheus suggests that the figure of Frankenstein is that of a hero where people have an immense hope in people like Frankenstein who would change their history and their culture, who would bring about a sense of revolution. So that again is something very becomes very difficult to analyze because Frankenstein does not always remain the hero or the central consciousness of the novel. Increasingly his acts get questioned, even as he is at the center of the plot. His acts also get questioned, that he does not show that kind of responsibility towards his creation. And should he have actually socialized the monster that he created? Why did he leave him? Just the very first look of the monster when he creates, he's filled with this kind of joy for creating this this new being, and he thinks he is discovering a new thing of immortality. He starts his search on that basis, that I'm going to focus on the elixir of life, that is the looking for immortality. And when he's able to create a being that has life, infuse life in a being, then he feels he's discovering something. But as soon as that happens, as soon as that object becomes animate, opens its eyes, he has a sense of, he feels a kind of repulsion towards it. He abhors the look of it. Is it the physical appearance of the monster that creates that this kind of repulsion? Why did he flee? He leaves the house and does not want to return. He is so shocked at his own work. Is it a kind of a sudden revelation that about what he has done? Is it a kind of guilt that he experiences, that he has actually gone in the direction of the forbidden? what has been forbidden, he has gone and pursued that knowledge, attained that knowledge, and now what he has created as a result of it is this kind of monster who is going to pursue him and see the death of him finally in the novel. So that is the sense, that is the, so the myth of Prometheus keeps, it becomes a kind of a constant reference point in the novel that that we keep returning to, and we can always analyze it on that basis. Now, moving from the subtitle to the epigraph of the novel. The epigraph, as I said earlier, has been taken from Paradise Lost, Book 10, when man's transgression is known and Adam speaks and is actually speaks aloud about his own condition. And in that moment, he says something, it's an oft-quoted line of Milton, but that Mary Shelley uses as a kind of epigraph for her novel is again reflective of her larger perspective. And here Adam says, and I quote, "Did I request thee, Maker, from my clay to mold me, man? Did I solicit thee from darkness to promote me?" Unquote. How would you like to comment on this?
Posing a problem.
Right. He's asking a question, and that question is going to be pursued now by the author here.
Yeah.
So she is using it very deftly.
Right.
Borrowing a question from Milton, from his text,
and then for Adam. You see, that's what she, that's where she mixes these categories. Mm-hmm. So, you see, even as used it seemed, you would try, even if you were to take the Miltonic allegory and apply it to the text, you would think that the giant is Satan. But here, the giant says, "I am Adam. Mm-hmm. I am your Adam. How do you take away that?" And this particular line, of course, is as if it is spoken by the monster, who is actually nameless in the text, who doesn't have the name, who is not given a name, and it is his voice, in fact, that she captures here in this epigraph when he says, "Did I request you to make me, Maker, and mold me in the shape of man, and did I solicit you to bring me out of darkness and to promote me to this world? I did not. The idea is, of course, that I did not. If you did, then you are responsible for me." You know, so that of a problem, that whether to place this monster in the category of Satan or to place him in the category of Adam, and are they any different? Is Satan different from Adam? And, you know, so how many different
layers? I would like to, quote as a kind of question that is formed by the romantic imagination. The romantic imagination is not able to distinguish between Adam, the human being, from the explorer, from the protester, from the rebellious, and the rebellion on the other side is associated with Satan. So there is an element of Satan in it, and that element is given a positive coloring by this author. And she is doing it in the early 19th century.
And she is doing it deftly as a kind of a, you know, following a literary tradition.
Yes.
Using the myth of Prometheus or of Adam, quoting from Milton and Coleridge. So it's almost like a canonical text in her own right that she is creating, using something from pulp fiction that itself was looked down upon by most writers at the time. Most writers who wrote in the elite circles would look down upon pulp fiction of this kind. But she's bringing this pulp fiction out of its own, you know, commercial attributes that or spectacle element, and bringing it up to the level of ideas and introducing ideas.
And that is the act of courage.
Right.
You know, taking pulp fiction, and pulp fiction is, you know, rooted also in the common man's experience.
Exactly. So it is mass experience. She knows that it has mass appeal, and yet she is able to bring in ideas in some, in a genre which is liked by the masses.
And imagine,
which others would look down upon.
And imagine when ideas reach the common masses who are not able to take them properly, what is going to happen?
What's going to happen? That's very true. And as I said that, you know, she says, now let me quote what Mary Shelley says in 1836. Of course, much later, the book came out in 1818, but it's now a mature Mary Shelley who's looking back at her own work. And, you know, at one point she says in 1836 on the French Revolution, and I quote, "The giant now awoke. The mind never torpid, but never roused its full energies, received the spark which lit it into an unextinguishable flame." unquote.
So this is a positive kind of expression.
So the idea is that when she visualizes a giant, you see, in the novel, the monster is called a fiend, the miserable monster, or the giant. So you see the idea. It's always seen as repulsive. He evokes fear in people. So you know, in a way, the kind of political allegories that have been seen, you know, this novel has been seen. They try to see the giant as a form of the masses, where the giant actually is represented in the image of the French Revolution, when the masses awoke. When the giant awoke is when the masses awoke, then this kind of energy came in and it was terrifying and horrific for some, for man. So you see how she's able to tread, and which is why I said that this novel can be interpreted as a dystopic science fiction or a gothic novel, or for that matter a horror thriller, and also a political allegory or a religious allegory.
And the two being different.
Yes.
When it's a gothic novel, you are undermining the scope of imagination here.
Right.
But when the same thing assumes your proportions of change,
right,
then it goes in the opposite direction.
Right. So when it can be read as a political allegory or a religious allegory. So you know, these levels of interpretations exist in the text.
When the sense of protest ceases to be satanic, and when it becomes, you know, a part and parcel of the common man's outlook, then the entire thing changes radically.
Yes, that's true. So in that sense it is, and you see, and which is why this text was seen to be such a contradiction, that you know, I'd like to actually quote from the Quarterly Review of 1818. In March it came out, and this is the review that they gave of the book. And this is what they said, and I quote, "Our taste and our judgment alike revolt at this kind of writing. And the greater the ability with which it may be executed, the worse it is. It inculcates no lesson of conduct, manners, or morality. It cannot mend and will not even amuse its readers, unless their taste have been deplorably vitiated. It fatigues the feelings without interesting the understanding. It gratuitously harasses the heart and only adds to the store already too great of painful sensation."
I call it a kind of posing a problem.
Yes.
And not suggesting an answer.
Right.
But the problem is that we're monstrous. And monstrous is not definitely devilish.
Right.
Monstrous can be just big in size and something that is abnormal. But abnormal is not necessarily wrong. So she's giving a new color to.
Right. And which is, you see, the point in this review is that it doesn't take, when the writer says here that it doesn't inculcates any kind of conduct, manners, or morality. And that is where the freshness and the exploration is, that she is not following the toad line. She's in fact giving various shades and colors to all her characters.
What is the reviewer's opinion? Is he attacking her? Or
yes, of course, criticizing the book. Criticizing the book for, you know, he says, "Our taste and our judgment alike revolt at this kind of writing." That's the first line that is used here. So the idea is that our judgments revolt against it and our taste revolt against it.
I think it's an anti-romantic review and must be the voice of Toryism at that
time. Yeah, it is. Quarterly Review was a kind of a Tory review, and therefore it's prejudice
and
against.
And a large part of the 20th century is a kind of Toryism, starting from T.S. Eliot onwards.
Right,
Romantics were always, you know, targeted by modernism in the 20th century. So maybe this review is a kind of precursor to the prejudices that the 20th century later on adopted.
Yeah, because it goes on to say that the reader is in doubt whether the head or the heart of the author is most diseased. This is what the review says.
Yes.
You know, and then people didn't think. Also, you see, we also have to see that Mary Shelley, being a woman in that age, was able to write such gory stuff of murders and, you know, this kind of horror, building a monster and talking about it. So people didn't expect. In fact, you know, in one of the letters, there's Lord Dillon who says that your writing and your manners are not in accordance. That what you write and the kind of person you are, they're absolutely very different. And he said, "I should have thought of you, if I had only read you, that you were a sort of Sibyl, outpouringly enthusiastic, rather indiscreet and even extravagant. But you are cool, quiet and feminine to the last degree. I mean, in delicacy of manners and expression. Explain this to me."
See the kind of rebuke that, right. that is hidden in the entire question.
Also this kind of confused sensibility. Mm. So much so that Leigh Hunt, the famous poet of the time, who wrote a poem on Shelley in this regard, in his poem The Blue Stocking Revels, he says, and I quote, "And Shelley, forefamed for her parents, her lord, and the poor lone impossible monster abode, so sleek and so smiling she came, people stared to think such fair clay should so darkly have dared." Unquote.
Yes. Yeah.
So the idea that, you know, how could a fair woman, petite and smiling, could dare to write things of you know, that had darkly, etc. So you see, that's the kind of, from a feminist point of view, also these questions become interesting, that how was she perceived and how she shocked by the very kind of writing she presented. While they expected her to write beautiful stuff, aesthetic stuff that women were supposed to write, and what kind of monsters she produced, you know, in her head. Very much like Emily Bronte and Charlotte Bronte in that tradition, you know, they were able to write about female monsters as well, such as Bertha Mason in Jane Eyre.
As I hear you talk about these things, I realize that perhaps romanticism in these writings, in the critical writing, is being demonized. Because they are considering it as a kind of disease, as you say, something dark, so something unformed.
You see, the point is that it is diseased because it's a woman writer. And that it doesn't come up to that expectation. They wouldn't call Wordsworth's writing, for instance, diseased in that sense. Because one, he's a male writer and he's a poet who's talking about elated sublime subjects. Here she's going into the pulp mode, you know. So of course, when she takes things out from there, then and she is not able to give you a moral code of conduct. So, in that sense, she has
a shock value.
She has a shock value. And in the 19th century at a time. But of course, I mean, she's Mary Wollstonecraft's daughter. What else do you expect?
This kind of parentage, you know.
Yes, of course. She's meant to be. But her outward appearance and the kind of stuff that she wrote, they were not in accordance.
But
and this also shocked the readers.
This was
readers.
A deadly combination.
Right.
Godwin, Wollstonecraft, P.B. Shelley.
Right.
And then Mary Shelley. It's a kind of
explosive
device.
You know, though she's not like this kind of an extravagant person. She, in fact, does not want to play the part of the feminist. And in fact, when she writes, as I said, the introduction to Frankenstein in 1831, then she is almost apologizing for what she has written. So it's not like she is wearing it on her sleeves, or there is a kind of propaganda that goes along with it. That is her person. In fact,
no. You see, in fact, that becomes much more deadly, because she has a kind of temperament, you know, which is balanced, which is very rational, and in that rationality, she is raising questions that inconvenience people,
right.
You know, that shock people.
Right.
That's so, if it were just a kind of stormy petrel, people wouldn't take her seriously. But she carries conviction with her. So I think it's a great writer, but presenting a great writing. In fact, I'd like you to also comment on you know, that aspect. You know, where you talked about Indian writing. This is precisely the period when new modern writing emerges in India. The same 1820, 1825, 1830, Young Bengal comes up. And, you know, these people take to this aspect in a very fascinating manner. Almost all the Indian English writing of the time is getting inspiration from these romantic writers. And perhaps the sleeping giant that you talk of, and the monster that you think of, is perhaps the Indian masters also at the same time. It is for this reason that, you know, in the 20th century, modernists will come hammer and tongs, not merely at romanticism, but also at the colonial world. So that colonial world perhaps is the monster. Maybe there is a colony inside England itself. So those deprived masses. So that's the bigger picture, but I think this kind of a text and your interpretation adds, you know, grist to this kind of mill, in a very, very positive sense.
Yes. Lastly, you know, I would just like to, in a nutshell, also talk about the way the novel progresses, in the sense that, you know, what is this desire? Like Frankenstein, who's supposed to be a pure inquirer after truth, it's his obsession with science, with discovering something, that leads to his creating this kind of monster. Once that monster is created, he shows this kind of lack of responsibility towards that monster. In fact, he feels repulsed, and that is the result is a grotesque being that Victor loathes to see. And you know, this is there because he has put together. There is also a sense that he's put parts of the dead men together and formed something. So something as unnatural as that is going to have unnatural results. So you see, this is how the novel actually progresses, that he loathes to see this kind of a person. And you know, he says in the novel, in fact, that how can I describe my emotions at this catastrophe, or how delineate the wretch whom with such infinite pains and care I had endeavored to form. So the idea is that he took two years went into this of reaching the results, and instead of being proud of his results, he actually faces a pang of guilt, and the physical appearance of the monster then creates a feeling of repulsion in him. And increasingly, because the monster now has been rejected, he turns to evil ways. And you see, in fact, you will find that the David Punter, in his essay Gothic and Romanticism, he asserts that, and I quote, "The monster is the creature, the embodiment of Frankenstein's desire," unquote. The idea is that it is Frankenstein's desire that has created this monster, and therefore, you know, he required to be acculturated, as Punter says, that the monster had to be acculturated instead of being exiled. Had he been socialized or brought into culture, he wouldn't have taken to these kind of devious ways. It is the rejection that he receives, it leads to this kind of a the evil in the monster. So and then, as you see, what the things that take place, the monster does not runs away. Frankenstein thinks he's free of the monster, but when he returns to his home in Geneva and murders his youngest brother, it is then that he thinks that this monster is not a harmless person. He is going to be revengeful. He, in fact, at each turn, the monster is revengeful. He tells Frankenstein that you are my creator, but I am your master. So you obey me. You create a female monster for me. Otherwise, I will make sure that each one that you love dies. And this, so in a way, the position of the creator and the created also gets changed. The one who created is now being pursued by the one who was created. He has become a slave to his own creation. And of course, it reads into many levels, again going into the allegorical question. But, you know, he asks a very relevant question also, the monster, to Frankenstein. He says, how dare you sport thus with life? You know, so the whole idea of, you know, how dare you meddle with nature? So, and if you have, then you must, you know, stand up to it. And he asks him to create a female monster, which Frankenstein thinks of doing. He starts the project, he makes a female monster, but then destroys it.
What sense do we make today of work like Frankenstein? This might be the summing up of your lecture also.
Yeah, in the sense that I think what Mary Shelley is trying to project is that one has to be responsible for the actions. You might, in a state of fury or in a state of impulse, the scientific truth or you know the obsession might take you somewhere, but then you need to delimit it and also be responsible for your acts. So science can't be unbridled, in Mary Shelley's view. It can't just have its way in an unbridled kind of world. It must be guided by emotion, feeling, ethos, value system, and society at large.
So, viewers, we have heard a discussion on this thing by Dr. Richa Bajaj. And as you would have seen, science cannot be left to its own ways. It has to be harnessed by human imagination and human wisdom. Then only it can play a positive role. And that seems to be the message of this book called Frankenstein. I hope you have enjoyed the lecture and you will think further about these questions that Dr. Richa Bajaj has raised. Thank you. And thank you, Dr. Bajaj.
Thank you.